today, April 2nd, 2023. And before we begin, let us begin with a word of prayer. Our Holy Father, we thank you once again that you touched us, Lord, and you saw fit to let us see another bright and beautiful, wonderful day, Lord. We thank you for keeping us all last week and allowing us to see this new day, Lord. Allow us to study your word, Lord. We pray that your word would sink deep down in our souls and that we would just not be hearers, but we will be doers of the word as well. We thank you, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Our lesson title today is Amazing Encounters, The Empty Tomb, and it comes out of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. And today is Palm Sunday, the day that Jesus triumphantly entered into Jerusalem and the day that he publicly presented himself as the Messiah. And the crowd was excited, ecstatic. They just gave him glory. They praised him. They put a cloak on the donkey that he was riding on, and they covered the streets with their clothes, and they said, "Bless the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." They just praised him for all the miracles and the work that he has done. He had done. And this lesson picks up after that. This lesson actually picks up after the crucifixion. And as the title tells us, it's an amazing encounter, the empty tomb. And we will begin. And I'll be reading the first four verses, which our Sunday school lesson titles First Encounter. Verse 1 begins, "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared." And so we reflect that. And during the lesson, we know that all the Gospels talk of the crucifixion and also of the empty tomb. So we'll be going, we'll gather some information from the other Gospels to get a clear picture, a full picture of what occurred. So we know that Jesus was crucified on Friday, and after his burial, the tomb was sealed with a heavy stone, and it was guarded by Roman soldiers. And the body was hastily prepared for the burial by Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. And this, they that they're speaking of in this verse are the women. They are the loyal and the faithful and committed women that followed Jesus during his ministry. They sat at his feet. They listened to his sermons, his teachings. They witnessed his miracles that he performed. And some were even funding his ministry. They cared for him and no doubt encouraged and supported him in every way. So I can just imagine, though, that after his burial, how anxious the women were waiting for the first day of the week after the Sabbath. They were waiting for the first day of the week so they could go back to, so they could go to the tomb and complete the burial process or properly prepare his body. So I can imagine they didn't sleep well and they were pacing and they were just anxious. They loved him and they just wanted to do this final act for him. And so verse 2 says they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And the Gospel of Matthew points out that there was an earthquake and that angel from heaven descended. And the angel rolled back the stone and sat upon the stone. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. And so the guards naturally shook, and they became as dead men. The Gospel of Mark talks about how the women had a discussion about how are we going to get this stone? Because as I said, the stone was heavy and it took several men to move it. So they were wondering how they were going to get the stone removed. And sometimes we know in life that we can't see that clear picture, but we have to get up on faith, and when we're doing something for the Lord, we know that He's going to make it happen. And so it was with them. They just got up and they were heading to the tomb, and they didn't know what was going to happen, but they were heading on their way. The tomb most likely had a small entrance and perhaps one or more of the compartments where bodies would lay. You know, however, we knew this was a new tomb in which no one had been laid in. And the bodies were wrapped in strips, and they said that the spices were smeared on the strips with aloe and ointments. And John's Gospel also tells us that the tomb was near the crucifixion. Verse 3 says, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. So these women, by God's will, by the providence of God, witnessed with the first to witness this empty tomb. And they were amazed, to say the least. They were not expecting this. This was probably the furthest thing from their mind. And they probably thought that, here we go again, you know, how they reflected back how Jesus suffered on the cross, shame and pain. And now they're probably thinking that somebody has stolen his body. So the second encounter begins with verse 5. And it said the women were terrified and they bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. And so the women see the angels and they knew that this was from heaven. So they bowed down, but they were afraid. They were perplexed. They still didn't know what was going on. And the angel finally tells them, Jesus is not here. He has risen. Why are we looking for him here? He's not here. When we go to verse 6, it says, remember how he told you while he was in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day would rise again. Then they remembered his words. Have you ever experienced somebody telling you something that was important when you reflected back over later, but it just like went over your head, you know, you heard it, but you didn't comprehend, you didn't digest it, you didn't think about it again. And so I'm sure that the women, when they reflected back on his teachings and what he said, that they did remember what he said. Jesus died and had risen from the dead as he predicted. And of course, most of the Gospels have verses where Jesus plainly tells his disciples that he would die, yet he would arise. I'm going to read Luke 18, verses 31 through 33. And it says that gathering the 12 disciples around him, Jesus told them, as you know, we are going to Jerusalem. And when we get there, all the predictions of the ancient prophets will come true. He will be handed over to the Romans to be mocked. That occurred. He will be treated shamefully and spit upon. That occurred. And they will whip him and kill him. They did that. But on the third day, he would rise again. Verse 34 said, but they didn't understand the thing that he said. Its significance was hidden from them, and they failed to grasp what he was talking about. But Pilate remembered that Jesus made his own prediction about his own resurrection, so that's why Pilate ordered the stone to be placed in front of the tomb to seal it. The third encounter talks about, it begins with verse 9, and it says, and turned from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Again, nursing women to deliver this most important and life-changing message to the disciples. The women were excited because they had witnessed for themselves the empty tomb. They saw for themselves the angels and heard his words and his instructions to go tell the disciples that Jesus had been raised from the dead. And Jesus said, "I'll meet you in Galilee." So they were excited and just happy, late, I'm sure, to know that their Savior, their beloved Jesus, was alive. Now, verse 10 says, now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. And, of course, we know that Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, which was not the John's brother, they call him the less James, were mentioned at appearing at a crucifixion. We know that Joanna also accompanied Jesus and provided for his needs. Her husband was a steward of Herod's affairs. And these, as I said earlier, these were faithful, loyal, and committed to Jesus and his ministry. I'm sure there are many more, but even for these, the names of these women to be mentioned was significant, especially during that time. They went to the disciples. Verse 11 said, but these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. And of course, during that time, and even during this time, often the opinions and what women have to say is not important or not taken seriously. Even in our lesson, page 9 in our lesson, it says that even though they drew the favor of heaven by being allowed to witness supernatural messengers who entrusted them with heavenly news right off the presence of eternity, they were still relegated to the constraints of society's low view on them. And as I said earlier, unfortunately, this has not changed much. Maybe some, but it's a lot of work needs to be done. And Jesus really included women. He had no respect for a person, and he used women. And we see that he's using them here. But it caught on, but not as much as it needed to be. Now, the fourth and final encounter, which the book has, says, but Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves. And he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. And of course, I guess Peter and John at least got a little curious and said, maybe we need to go check this out, that maybe something is going on. What if this is true? And in John's gospel, we learn that John and Peter were the first to appear at the tomb, John outrunning Peter, but and John looks in, but Peter goes in and enters the tomb. Peter was astonished, and it said John believed. But Peter knew something powerful must have happened. And I'm sure Peter started reflecting back on all the things that miracles that Jesus had done, all the things that he said. He probably remembered him rebuking him when Jesus told him that he would be killed and raised on the third day. And Peter said, oh no, heaven forbid. And so he probably remembered him denying him the three times. So verse 12 is the conclusion of the lesson as far as the scriptures say. But I thought about the title when it talks about the encounters. And certainly there were a lot of encounters there. Of course, the women encountered, the women and the soldiers encountered the angels, and the disciples encountered what the women had to say. But the most amazing encounter was the encounter of Jesus Christ, because he was alive. And after the resurrection, he was seen by men. The two men walking down the Emmaus Road. He was seen by Mary Magdalene. He was seen by the women. He was seen by the disciples. He was seen by the multitude. He is alive. He was walking through doors. There's no barrier. And he was even eating with them. Those are the amazing encounters that happen because he lived. This resurrection theme is the foundation of our Christian faith. Jesus paid the debt we owe, the debt we could not pay, ultimately defeating death. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We just praise him because we could not save ourselves. Our faith teaches us that Jesus was born of the Virgin. He lived among men. He was crucified. He died. He was buried. He was resurrection. He lives. He ascended to the Father, and he will return again. And it made me think about a song we used to sing, especially when we had, before COVID, when we had our Sunday school in on-site Sunday school lessons. And it said, God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy our pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. We need to go out and tell somebody today that our Savior lives. And if you want an amazing encounter like the rest of us, if you don't know Jesus, you just need to holler out, Jesus, what must I do to be saved? You need to return from your wicked ways and repent and just acknowledge that he is the Son of God and he came to save us, and you'll have that amazing encounter. And those of us that believe in him, we have that amazing encounter every day because his Spirit lives within us. He said it's better that if I go away, that you will have a comforter. So I just thank God for that empty tomb, but I thank God that Jesus is alive today. May he bless your soul. May you go out and tell your neighbors, your friends, strangers about the life and how much God loved us, that he sent his son, and that he suffered and died for our sins. Let us pray. Dear Lord God, our Savior, I thank you, Lord, that you live. I thank you that you loved us. You said there's no greater love than one that lays down his life for his friend. I thank you for your many, many blessings, Lord, and I thank you for the opportunity for eternal life. I pray, Lord, that we will go out and be witnesses for you, Lord, and that we will love one another as you have loved us. In Jesus' name, for his sake, I pray. Amen. Amen. That concludes our Sunday school lesson for today. I have a few announcements. Please join us today at 10:30 for our morning service that will be delivered by our very own Pastor Dr. Gallman. And also, next week, we will have revival on April the 4th and the 5th. And the title is Struggling to Accept. Our thing is We Are Healed. And that's out of Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 6. And on Tuesday night, Dr. David Elliott from St. James of Goldsboro will be deliver the message. And on Wednesday, Pastor Veronica Brown from First Baptist out of Princeton will deliver the message. I believe that's at 6:30. Did it begin at 6:45. Join us on Fridays, every Friday at 12 at noon for our unity prayer. And our lesson next week is Struggling to Accept. The disciples come to believe the resurrection. And again, we will be in Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 49. God bless you.